In the past 36 hours, Russia has launched nearly 100 missiles attacking Ukraine's water and energy supplies. With temperatures dropping, these Russian attacks aimed at exacerbating human suffering are particularly heinous. As Ukraine works to restore water and power to its citizens, the United States remains committed to the victory of a sovereign and independent Ukraine, and we are working to deliver air defense systems so Ukraine can continue to repel these attacks.
At this year's COP, we're working very closely with all of our allies, with many, many countries, and around the world in order to principally raise climate ambition. That's the fundamental goal. And we left Glasgow keeping alive the possibility of holding the Earth's temperature increase to 1.5 degrees. That's the goal, the scientifically established goal. And we secured very significant commitments from about 65% of global GDP to do exactly that.
The African Union's announcement of the signing of a cessation of hostilities between the government of Ethiopia and the Tigrayan People's Liberation Front represents an important step towards peace. The United States remains committed to supporting this African Union-led process and to partnering to advance peace in northern Ethiopia.
The Department of State is committed to countering the DPRK's unlawful nuclear and ballistic missile program and to keeping the pressure on the DPRK through multilateral sanctions. As part of that policy, the Rewards for Justice offers a reward of up to $5 million for information that leads to the disruption of financial mechanisms of individuals engaged in certain activities that support the DPRK.
Restitution and compensation are also ways of memorializing the truth about the Nazis' crimes, and thus continuing to educate our people and the world about the Shoah, so that its hideous crimes may not be repeated. Let us recommit ourselves today to meeting the righteous, just, and urgent goals set out in the Terezin Declaration, which are sacred not only to generations past and present, but to future ones as well. We're at an inflection point in history. The post-Cold War era is over. There is a competition on now to shape what comes next. And technology is at the heart of that competition. One way or another, it is going to retool our economies, it's going to reform our militaries, it's going to quite literally reshape our lives. In order both to capture the upsides of technology, but also to deal with the downsides, there's a number one imperative in working together. No single country, whether it's the United States, whether it's Germany, can actually effectively meet these challenges alone.
The G7 agreed to create a new coordination group to help repair, restore, and defend Ukraine's energy grid, the very grid that President Putin is brutalizing. Together with the G7, countries around the world are making clear to President Putin that any use of a nuclear weapon would be catastrophic for him and for Russia. All our countries are making sacrifices to sustain this critical support, and we're supporting each other in doing that. On energy, for example, the United States has exported 53 billion cubic meters of liquefied natural gas to Europe. That's nearly 2.5 times what we exported in 2021, and will provide our friends with a vital reserve as they head into the winter. the international community is sending a clear message to Moscow that it should stop using hunger as a bargaining chip and extend the grain deal long before it expires later this month. As we saw here in Munster, when it comes to addressing the fundamental challenges of our time, the world's leading democracies are aligned, we're united, we are working together as never before.